personal collection acquired over the past several years. So if this sounds like something that would interest you, well, I hope that you'll kick back, relax, get comfortable, and let's nerd out. So we are going to start off with some of the books from our personal collection. Most of them are children's books with some chapter books, since some of you may know we have a son. So we don't have too many advanced books, or what would you, books that teens through adults could read. And the reason for that is, well, for me personally, number one, I'm very particular about the authors that I read and the subjects and genres. And number two, ever since having a son, time has been limited. Some of you may be able to relate to that. And now that I have my passion here, spending time with you here on YouTube, time is even more limited. So instead of me having time to, in the past, before YouTube, having time to read or play video games, I spend that making videos. This is, like I said, this is my life's work now, besides being a father. So I wish I had more books, more works of fiction, more books on philosophy and such, but I just don't have the time. But maybe one day, before I die, right? So we're going to start off with some of the more, advanced books, just books for teens and through adults that kids wouldn't really read. And then we'll work into the kids' books. And these are all titles that I would recommend. And of course, it's all subjective, right? And it's like homework. Whenever somebody, suggests something to you, it's like you're getting homework, But anyway, so starting off here with Gaston or LaRue's The Phantom of the Opera. And I've never seen an opera. I don't know if I ever will. And it wasn't only until the past 10 years that I was interested in plays. I love plays now. We don't get to see them as much. But I have more of a appreciation for them. Anyway, the reason I purchased this book is because I have done some Phantom of the Opera ASMR videos, though not really the best. I do want to revisit the roleplay of the Phantom once I shave the beard, or if I ever shave the beard, I don't know. There's some videos I want to do that involve the beard first. One of the ideas I have is where the Phantom visits, the viewer as if they're caught in one of his traps, perhaps trying to rescue. I was going to say, what's her name? Christine Day. I guess you might call her. This is actually a really good book. I always had the incorrect misconception that it was going to be some kind of love story, which it is, but it's not just a romantic love story, and there's nothing wrong with those. But I'm just the type that prefers the horror genre. And thrillers. So this is a little bit of thriller mystery. So it's a great read, actually. So I definitely have more of an appreciation for everything. So this is the kind of necessary in order for me to try to even begin to play the Phantom from the Phantom of the Opera that I better read the book first. I can't just pretend to guess what I'm doing. So, that's that one. Next one we have is Let Me In by, I believe, a Swedish author. I think it's Swedish, if I'm not mistaken. John Lindqvist. And this, yeah, Swedish author. This is a great story. You may have heard of the movie, which I have. Both, there's an English version as well. But I definitely recommend this great horror mixed with the, they call him Sweden's Stephen King. Great story. A very unique story. I don't think a story has been told like this one before. Some creepy parts to it, but definitely worth checking out. I read this, picked this up after watching the film. I mean, the film was that good, the Swedish version of the film. I don't want to see the American version. And I watched the Swedish version with subtitles. I had to pick this up, and I'm glad I did, so I recommend that as well. I still need to pick up The Road. I know some, I've seen the film, but I really need to read I forget his first name, his last name is McCormack. So, let's get these children's books out of the way first, and we'll swing them back around to those. Here's a national bestseller called The Highly Sensitive Person. This is somewhat of a self-help book. Now, before anyone out there judges this book by its cover, this is not a spiritual book. This is not someone trying to push any kind of New Age philosophy. Basically, this psychologist and her a team of psychologists, I believe, put a name to a trait, what appears to be a trait, or I don't know how else better to put it, but how some folks, like myself, are what you might call highly sensitive. And that doesn't mean sensitive in the how the Western view has a, the word has a stigma of being weak or anything like that. It just basically means there are some people, and it seems to be a little scientific proof to that, that some folks have just a highly sensitive nervous system. They process things a lot more. Not that they're better, just a different way their nervous system works. And this book gives you a lot of insight, and it's just great to know. It's a little bit of a wake-up call, and it's good to know how that, you know, why you are like you are. And like I said, you know, I've done a couple of videos on this. It's very interesting. It's you know, like I said, I can relate to it, and I definitely recommend you checking it out. I could go on and on about that, but I don't want to dedicate a whole video to it just yet or just now. All right, moving on. We have Robert R. McCammon's Swan Song. This is, you can see, a very hefty book. Coming in at about, what do we got, 800, almost not 850 pages. I actually read this back in the 80s. Not sure exactly when it came out, I could look into it, but it's basically almost like a, it's a, yeah, post-apocalyptic. Swan Song is Robert McCammon's prescient and shocking, parentheses, John Saul, vision of a post-apocalyptic nation, a grand epic of terror and, ultimately, renewal. In a wasteland born of rage and fear, populated by monstrous creatures and marauding armies, Earth's last survivors have been drawn into the final battle between good and evil. That will decide the fate of humanity. Sister, who discovers a strange and transformative glass artifact in the destroyed Manhattan streets, Joshua Hutchins, the pro wrestler who takes refuge from the nuclear fallout at a Nebraska gas station, and Swan, a young girl possessing special powers, who travels alongside Josh to a Missouri town where healing and recovery can begin with Swan's gifts. But the ancient force behind Earth's devastation is scouring the walking wounded for recruits for its relentless army, beginning with Swan herself. So, definitely recommend that. Thus Spoke Zarathustra by Friedrich Nietzsche. I picked this up not because, you know, to be like, hey, look at me, I read Friedrich Nietzsche. I'm fascinated by the human condition. I love to know what makes people tick, what makes things tick. I just wanted to know more about Nietzsche and his philosophy. This is a tough read. It's got an old style form, writing form about it, style. But that's the way he intended to write it. It's somewhat of a creative, kind of like in a third person. He tells his personal philosophy through another character, more or less. So, try to read that just to get a little more insight. That's what it's all about, you know. It's not just about entertainment and having fun and enjoying this life to the fullest. It's also about trying to gain new perspective and understanding about this world, at least for me, you know. And trying to grow, personal growth, you know. Douglas Adams, the Hitchhiker, the ultimate hitchhiker. Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. This has all five novels by Douglas Adams. It has The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, The Restaurant at the End of the Universe, Life, the Universe, and Everything, So Long and Thanks for All the Fish, and Mostly Harmless. To me, the first one was really the best. I read the second one. I think I read the third, maybe the fourth. I mean, I think I enjoyed them. I can't remember. It's been decades, but definitely worth checking out. If you've, it's a mix of humor and sarcasm and science fiction. One of the greatest books I've ever read. So definitely recommend that. All right, the last advanced book is the complete fiction of H.P. Lovecraft. I don't know where I would be without this gentleman and his books. I don't know where horror writers today would be without him, because a lot of them, you know, you could say the horror genre pretty much started with H.P. Lovecraft. I mean, I'm not an expert on the horror genre, but a lot of folks always credit him. You know, I think Stephen King has, and I'm sure a lot of others. But anyway, this has every novel he ever wrote, and I think maybe some other short stories, and well, not novels, he wrote short stories. I think one of them, I'm not sure if one of them became a novel or not, but in any case, so if you're interested in reading anything by H.P. Lovecraft, you know, you can look into getting this. This has everyone, every story he ever wrote in it. It's great. I'm still trying to read them all again when I have time. All right, so that's more of the advanced books, you know, the books that teens and adults would understand, would be able to read. And of course, I read Stephen King's It, a few others, but I don't really have, I've never really greatly expanded my detriment. All right. So let's offer some kids' books. We got The Diary of a Wimpy Kid. Definitely recommend this once if you have kids or you know of some kids, once they get around 7, 8 years old, I would say this is probably a good chance for them to start. You know, everyone reads, accelerates differently, progresses at different ages and such. So that's our son has read, but we usually spend the nights reading the books to him. It's kind of a time for us to, you know, quiet down and all that. Here's Al at Home. This is one of the early books that we, by Arnold Lobel, and Frog and Toad All Year. These are pretty fun, little interesting little stories. Sample of the art right there. So definitely I would recommend checking those out. He's a good writer. Again, another little chapter book, The Notebook of Doom. It's a little kid's, a kid takes makes a little notebook of all the creatures and monsters, I guess, he encounters in the world, or something along those lines, his imagination. Captain Underpants, which is a very fun little book about two kids who, I know, I guess they do pranks and stuff like this, but it's not just all pranks. There's a superhero who turns into Captain Underpants, who I think is the principal of the school. Tom Engelberger's series of books about origami. This is called The Strange Case of Origami Yoda. Then there's also, where are they all? This is the first one. They're not all listed here. The second one, okay. All right, well, basically it's a story about some kids in school, and one of them has an origami Yoda that he uses to give advice. So it's a really good book, and there's a whole series of them. There's Origami Yoda, there's one with Emperor Palpatine, one titled something Chewbacca, and they're all somehow related to origami. But it's not about origami so much, like teaching you origami or anything. Okay, we have Max Braillier. I don't really know how to pronounce his name. The Last Kids on Earth. This is a post-apocalyptic chapter book. This is actually really good. Recommend this one. A bunch of kids try to survive the zombie apocalypse. So there's no parents around or anything like that, I don't believe. So that's a really good book too. Imogene's Antlers. This was a fun little book. This actually got a winner of a Parents' Choice Award for literature, about a little girl wakes up one day with antlers on her head, and now all the everyone in her life has to deal with it. So definitely recommend that. Goodnight Gorilla, just a fun little book about a gorilla who escaped, who lifts the key for all the cages at the zoo from the zookeeper, and all the other helps all the other animals escape. It has a nice little ending to it. My Friend Rabbit. This is a Caldecott metal book, and it's a nice little book about a squirrel and his friend Rabbit have a nice little misadventure of sorts. The Giving Tree by Shel Silverstein, of course, who also did the Where the Sidewalk Ends. This is a nice, great book. It can be a little for kids. Still great. Still a great book, nonetheless. And I love all these books, mostly. Books in general. I love all the variety of kids' books just because of the art and a lot of the stories and how almost everyone is different. Just amazing. If you give a mouse a cookie. I didn't know this book has been around for 25 years or more. Crazy. Fun little book. If you give your mouse a cookie, then he's going to ask for something else. And if you give him that, he's going to ask for something else. And it goes on and on and on. So definitely a fun book. Worth checking out. Good night, Moon. Nice little book. Mother rabbit, I think, that is saying goodnight to her little rabbit daughter or son, if I'm not mistaken. I think it's a rabbit. Yeah. And saying goodnight to everything in the room. So it's a very, that's more of a real kid's book there. A Sick Day for Amos McGee. This is about, I think, a guy that works zoo or zookeeper, if I'm not mistaken. He takes care of all the animals. He has a special relationship with all the animals, that's what you can glean from it. That's what I glean from it. He gets sick one day, and you'll just have to be the one to find out what happens. Corduroy. Again, this is a classic about a little bear that comes to life and becomes someone's friend. Skippy John Jones. This is a fun little book about a little Siamese cat who pretends that he is a chihuahua. He goes on all these adventures, or so to speak. Borreguita and the Coyote. Fun little tale. It's an old tale. Actually, I believe that's turned into a book. Yeah, it's a Mexican folk tale. By master storyteller Verna Ardima. So it's about a wolf that tries to eat a lamb. How she tries to trick him in order to not be eaten. How the Grinch Stole Christmas. I believe this is probably the only book that our son likes by Dr. Seuss, believe it or not. We have all the Dr. Seuss books, well, a lot of them, the more, One Fish, Two Fish, and Cat in the Hat, and we used to read to him when he was little, he's as he got older, he never really was a big fan, you know. He never asked for them, maybe because we read them so much, and maybe because he associates them with when he was real little, and over the years, as he's gotten older, he just didn't want anything to do with that, that he was a baby at one point or whatever. So, you gotta have Dr. Seuss, in your house. So, The Polar Express, this is a great Christmas book. Great artwork. That's definitely, having, I would say. Now, these next series of books are illustrated by one particular writer by the name of David Wisner, and there is no words. You have to actually figure the story out just by looking at the illustrations, and it's just beautiful. This one's called Tuesday. The story about some frogs who've gained the ability, special little ability, to fly, so to speak. This one is Art and Max. Story about two little lizard friends who have a little misadventure of sorts with some paints. There is a little in this one. There's a little bit of words, but not so much. Especially not in this one. Flotsam. This is the first one that we owned. It won an award. There's no words in this. And this is a story about a young boy goes to the beach and finds some photos, some special photos, and all the illustrations tell the story. So it's challenging to read that to a kid. All right, moving on. We have click clack. Moo, cows that type, which is a really fun little book. The cows threaten to go on strike if they don't get some blankets to keep them warm. Where the wild things are, I'm sure this book needs no introduction. Definitely just a great, you know, a lot of these, you know, should do a role play about this as if we are in the jungle hiding from the wild things. Maybe kind of interesting. One of the night before Christmas. I think this is probably the most beautiful, well-illustrated Christmas book I've ever seen. Gotta have a Christmas book, I think. Yeah. So that's a beautiful one. Classic, you know, the classic story, Night Before Christmas. We have Snowflake Bentley. Story about I'm not sure if it's a true story, it may be fictional, but it's about interest in photographing snowflakes, from what I can remember. So it's more than that, but and another fun little book, The Day the Crayons Quit, which is a great story, I think. Each little crayon basically takes up a complaint with the little boy that uses them to color, and how they're tired of being used a certain way or not used very often. So that's a good one. So I hope you found this interesting so far. Some of the books that we own, we actually don't buy too many anymore, as we prefer to go to the library. Although we have a lot more books that we have, a lot of books that we have bought. This is like a third of them. I can't recommend and highly suggest enough, read to your kids, read yourself if you're an adult, you don't have any kids, but especially if you have kids, just read as often as you can. It's great to spend time together, and it just does amazing things for their minds, and I think opens up their minds as well to new interesting ideas and things like that. And, you know, you can always go to the library. So many books in today's libraries. It's just amazing when you walk into the children's section. It's ridiculous. It's great. All right, so that's it for the book section, and now we are going to move on to the movies. All right, so now we're going to take a look at most of the films that we own. And some children's movies as well, kids' movies. Although I'm just a big kid myself, so they're movies just the same as far as I'm concerned. We don't really purchase movies anymore, really. We're pretty much, you know, watching them in the theater once and that's it. You know, or, you know, rent it. Don't really feel the need to purchase that many movies, so most of these have been acquired years ago, and, you know, a half dozen, you know, maybe a little bit more acquired over the recent years, but honestly not that many. With that, just gonna get started here. This was recommended by some viewers after I received a special package from ASMR YouTuber Urar1966. We did a package exchange, and he sent me a deck of cards. I didn't know what they were from, and they were actually cards based on the Spirited Away, this film. Beautiful animated film. You have to see it. I mean, everything in here, you really have to see if you haven't seen. That's just, you know, I'm giving you homework, but, you know, you're gonna look, you know, watch it on your own terms or not, but this is great. And there's a character in here who I would love to roleplay as, so we'll see if that ever happens to wear a mask, but definitely check that out. Of course, probably my favorite film of all time, Alien. I definitely plan some more roleplay videos with this, especially once a certain package arrives. I've tried to do some things in the past, but just wasn't up to par on what I know that I can probably do or do better. Love this, the first one, the atmosphere, the horror elements, the creature. I mean, it's just, it never gets old. It's timeless, really. E.T., this is quite dated now, but I will never forget this anniversary limited edition. I'll never forget watching this in the theater when it came out, and it just captivated my imagination. One of the greatest films of all time, I think. A lot of people don't like it or hate E.T., but definitely dated now. Not quite the same watching it today. Bambi, I'll never forget seeing this when I was a kid. Of course, introduced it to our son. And we watched it a couple times. It's just something that I feel like I needed to own. So this was purchased when our son was much younger. A lot of these Disney classics, I feel, are must-haves if you've seen them. Especially if you have kids, introduce them to them. I mean, just the art, the animation was just great. And the stories as well. Another top 10 movie, more of an animated, I'm not sure if it's CGI, but Dragon Hunters. Not exactly what you think, somewhat as far as the title itself is concerned, but it's not so much what the title is about that this, or this, what this title conveys, that the movie is about. Some good group of two good friends go on a really great adventure, and the soundtrack to this is amazing. The art, the animation is amazing. Again, I think it might be CGI. It's not a cartoon. So that is definitely something you have to check out. Inglourious Bastards. Saw this in the theater and just loved it. Great film. Would love to do a role play ASMR video on this, Quentin Tarantino, this is a classic film. Winter's Bone, this is a great drama / thriller. It won Best Screenplay and Best Picture, Sundance Film Festival. So if you like, dramas and thrillers, it's somewhat of a slow burn. After her deadbeat father jumps bail and mysteriously disappears. 17-year-old Ree Dolly must find a way to track him down, or she'll be left without a home or custody of her two young siblings. So it's a great story. Planet Earth. This is the David Attenborough version. I wish I got the Sigourney Weaver version, which I thought was just better. I like it. No disrespect to Sir David Attenborough, of course, but this is just a breathtakingly beautiful masterpiece of a documentary about so many facets of our world. Wildlife, different sceneries, different, you know, it's just really amazing. I forget how many discs there are here. Four Blu-ray discs. 550 minutes. So that's 7 hours. 8 hours. 9 hours. Yeah, 9 times 6 is 54, so. Tonight it's too late. Anyway, you gotta own this. I would have to say, if you have a Blu-ray. If you don't own a Blu-ray or video games, I highly recommend getting a PS4 or PS3 because it plays Blu-rays. There was a time when Blu-rays first came out and became the dominant HD format compared to there's another format. Anyway, not all Blu-ray players could play every Blu-ray disc. Strange, I know, but I'm not sure if that's the case today still. Any case, I would still recommend owning a PlayStation just because you can watch, you know, movies, Blu-ray movies in it without any problems and have a video game system. Okay. I don't have any Xbox experience, so I can't really recommend that. Of course, a classic, The Labyrinth, rest in peace, David Bowie. I miss these movies. I wish there was more of these films with the animatronics, but I think that age is gone, unfortunately. CGI apparently is the way to go, but there's just something about animatronics being able to film them in natural lighting, in natural environments, or even on sets, you know, compared to CGI. But Labyrinth, definitely a classic. Corpse Bride by Tim Burton. We also own The Nightmare Before Christmas. And of course, Edward Scissorhands. But this was pretty good. Another classic, The Dark Crystal. Again, animatronics and Jim Henson's work. This is a little bit dated, but it's still a beautiful film nonetheless. Great story, unique story. Blade Runner. A great film. I don't even know if I really need to say anything about it. If you haven't seen it, you must see it. Little sci-fi noir thing going on. That's just a great film. How to Train Your Dragon. This is a fun little movie. I enjoyed it. Great little fantasy CGI film with lots of dragons, and it's got nice, got some heart to it. So we love that. That's one of my favorites. Animated films: Batman Under the Red Hood, where the Red Hood, Jason Todd, who was the second Robin, he shows up sling blade. This is just a great, great story. I didn't see it when it first came out, but this is the must see. Just the amazing atmosphere and the characters, just everything about it is amazing. This is the Swedish version of the book Let Me In, Let the Right One In. Great visuals, great atmosphere. Just, I love putting this in. There's a certain mood about it that I love. Just great. Move these over here a little bit. Or maybe we'll put them back there. Okay. The Polar Express with Tom Hanks. So it's the animated or CGI, I forget, version of the book. This is actually great. Love it. This is really well done. Love that. Nice story. Sam Raimi's Evil Dead 2. Of course, all three are great. They kind of got a little bit more away from the horror, more a little bit more comedy, and goofiness, I think. In the Army of Darkness, but this is number two. Still, to me, this is the best one, I think. And of course, starring Bruce Campbell, Hail to the King, baby. Another must see. Of course, Ghostbusters. I will ever forget. You know, this is just a classic. Saw this in the theaters when it came out. I understand they're making like a number four with some female actors. Nothing against female actors or anything like that taking over the lead roles, but they should have stopped at number one. Really, you can't follow up to Bill Murray and Dan Aykroyd, and you can't recreate lightning in a bottle, you know? City. This is a great sci-fi, another sci-fi noir type film. Great story, great interesting theme, great atmosphere, interesting characters, and a little bit of the inspiration from the doctor in here, from My Plague Doctor. And actually, I would love to role play. I thought about it. I may get around to that. Maybe the doctor, but what's going on in that movie? I would love to roleplay that and do my little take on it. There's A Nightmare Before Christmas by Tim Burton. Just a classic. Great animated stop-motion film. Love his stuff. Trainspotting. Great film if you haven't seen it. A little bit depressing, but great characters and a great film nonetheless. Sleeping Beauty, just another Disney classic that I think you just have to own. Of course, our son loved the ending. I mean, who doesn't, right? Classic. American Psycho. I didn't really see this actually until about 2 years ago. For the first time. I think it was about 2 years ago. And I'm at the suggestion of some viewers, I think I might have heard about it, but I just missed it. Didn't really think too much about it. Great film. And again, something else I would love to do my take on. Edward Scissorhands. Hopefully you've seen this one. Needs no introduction, I don't think. Great. Great film. And Johnny Depp. Amazing actor. So talented and versatile when it comes to acting. Here's the Star Wars complete collection. I'm not a huge fan of the first three movies. The Phantom Menace, Attack of the Clones, and Revenge of the Sith. My my favorite is Empire Strikes Back. I think most people think that as well. I think Return of the Jedi could have been better without the Ewoks. I don't want to be too critical of the films, but... and I feel bad that we kind of ruined the mystique about Star Wars. We showed them in order to our son, so we already knew that Darth Vader was Luke's father. So, that whole scene, I think it was Strikes Back when Vader tells Luke he's his father, just didn't have the same wow factor. And I think I just ruined him for life. I actually think that, like, I just ruined the whole series for him because I showed that, you know. That'll be, like, one of the things he'll always hold against me when he gets older. Blue Valentine. This is a great film, a little bit of a romantic film. It's very interesting. A couple has a daughter, and they try to kind of save their relationship, and has a very interesting ending to it. But it's a great film, and I'm a huge fan of, I have to actually look at his name, because I'm getting old here. Ryan Gosling. I love almost every film that he's in. Great actor. Hellboy 2. The first one was good, but the second one with Ron Perlman as well, but I like the second one better. Hopefully they make a number three. Just kind of quickly moving here, because we're already almost at an hour. A little set here of all the Christmas classics: Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, Frosty the Snowman, and some others, but mostly purchased for these two films. You know, how can you not own these Christmas classics, right? Even though they show them on TV, just felt like something that we needed to own so we could watch it when they're not on TV. But we hardly ever watch it anymore. A Bug's Life. This was a really good, you know, I used to watch this a lot, not so much anymore. But it's a really good story, really fun. About the world of insects and what's going on with them and their little ant colony and the different types of bugs that they all meet. Toy Story, classic. I enjoyed this, of course. Not sure if I would have seen any of these movies if we didn't have our son. Probably not. I don't know. Can't really say. Another classic, Charlie Brown Christmas. Christmas time is here again, something like that. Anyway, how can you not own, how can you not love that classic? Kung Fu Panda. Jack Black as the panda just is a great, fun film. Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, these are all the classic Disney films: Fantasia, Alice in Wonderland, and Pinocchio. So just you know, had to own the Walt Disney classics. All right, that's it for the movies. We're gonna move on to the video games. So take a look at our video game collection, starting with Bloodborne, and I am like really close to putting out the first of a series of roleplay videos that I want to do for this. It's probably going to take me months to go through all the different things that I like to do, anyway, this game is just between that and The Last of Us. It's a tough choice, but I'm really leaning just the atmosphere and the fact can't say. It's a really tough call between that and The Last of Us. The combat in this is brutal, and I love it. Although you can, you know, you if you've played the Dark Souls or Demon Souls or a series of games before, you're used to it. But if you've never played a game like this before, you're in for a little bit of a challenge. Not much story, so a lot of it is left up to your imagination, which is just kind of like how H.P. Lovecraft, as well as, I believe, the writer or producer behind the games, Japanese gentleman by the name of Mitsuyaki or Mitsu something along those lines. I don't want to butcher his name, but the way he wrote left the lore open. So, really in love with the game, the atmosphere, and the Lovecraft-esque parts to it. So, The Last of Us, if there's any game you should ever play, it would have to be this one. I would have to say, for the story, one of the greatest games of all time. It's really tough to choose between this and Bloodborne. The story and the emotions of this game and the details and the graphics and the length of it. I mean, I really think it would beat Bloodborne. But like I said, what I love about Bloodborne, you know, it's really hard for me to choose. But I want to do a role play of this as well. So, but I want to do Bloodborne first. We have the Uncharted. Uncharted 3, Uncharted 2, series of games, and Neil Druckmann, the guy behind The Last of Us, actually did Uncharted 4, and this was the best Uncharted I've ever played. I'm sure a lot of folks might agree. Some of the combat, and some of the climbing around the environments, the sequences became a little long in the tooth. There was even an interview where I believe Neil Druckmann said, you know, they had to force some combat into things. But anyway, this was really good story, and you can see it's got Neil Druckmann all over it. Just the way that he did was behind The Last of Us. You can see that here with Uncharted 4. So these series of games, I definitely would say something you have to check out. A lot of fun. And some nice good story, too. Dark Souls. I'm not a fan of this one. Just the lore. Just not doing it for me. Demon Souls, I loved. And I thought I would love Dark Souls, too. But I found it a little lacking. So, it's just a game, I don't find it I'm not compelled to play it as much as I am with Bloodborne, so, and that's sad. Demon Souls, I wish I had it. I sold it, just that was a classic when that first came out, just took the gaming community by storm, I think, in the unique, brutal gameplay style where, you know, you would die a lot and have to start over. So, and the epic boss battles too. The epic boss battles are there in Bloodborne, but they seem to be a little bit more epic in the Demon Souls games. At least, maybe not. In any case, here's Ico and the Shadow of Colossus Collector's Edition. It's the collection of two of the games together, remastered in high def. Beautiful games. I'm almost finished Shadows of the Colossus. I purchased this like 3 years ago, and I still say I'm almost finished. Ico is a great game, great little story there. This is a very unique games, somewhat his style, and the soundtrack and the characters just definitely have to check this out. You just have to. Okay, moving here to a few Wii U games. Pokken Tournament. Love this game. Brings about a dozen or so of Pokemon characters to life where you can battle each other. You can go online and battle. It's a shame there's so many Pokemon that I guess they had to limit on how many they could have in the game. It's great. A great experience. And our son, we all play, take turns, my wife and I and our son. That's a lot of fun. If you love Pokemon, I definitely would recommend, or you know someone that does and they have a Wii U, definitely get that game. Love it. Avoid Skylanders, because this is just a ripoff, in my opinion. The game is fun for kids when our son was younger, but he's grown out of it. The problem I would avoid with this is that all the characters in the game can't be played unless you purchase all the little figures. And they're all like $10, I think. Or maybe that's not, maybe not 10. They're somewhere between 5 and 10. And I mean, there's like 2 or 3 dozen characters you can play every time, and they release a new game every year. So you're talking about, this isn't just a $50 game. This can be like a $200 dollar game after you buy all the characters for it. So I mean it's a great marketing tactic, really. So you know, kudos to them for just, you know, and Disney's doing it too, and there's Lego doing it. It's a little out of hand, and you know, that's just, I think that, you know, I have an issue with a lot of this stuff when it comes to just how much seems to be just trying to capitalize. I feel bad for all the parents who have spent so much money, including us, into buying all those figures. But, you know, Yoshi's Woolly World, this is a fun game, cute game. You get to play as Yoshi. Yarn, he's actually made of yarn, and two people can play, so we all play co-op. Only two at a time. And it's a lot of fun. It's a whole yarn-based world. Kind of reminiscent of Sackboy, Little Big Planet. But just not somewhat similar. Not too similar. Anyway. Mario Kart 8. A lot of fun. A lot of racing. I think up to how many people locally. I know two can play locally. I think three, maybe. I'm not sure. But racing game for kids of all ages, of course. That's a lot of fun. And then Super Smash Brothers, which is where you get to play is all your favorite characters from so many different games. It's crazy battles. So this is, you know, just one of those fun little games. I mean, not fun little game, but, you know, I'm not going to go into too much detail with all these games just because of how long this video is. Ridiculously long. Did not intend this video to be this long, but here we are. Skyrim, I still have not finished this game. I have it on the PC, too. I need to finish it one day. It's just a shame. I just have so little time. This game needs no introduction. Beautiful game. Red Dead Redemption. This is a great Old West style game. Great story. Great ending. A lot of combat. Missions and side quests, but it's a lot of fun. I loved it. looking for a game where you can immerse yourself and take part in the Star Wars universe. This is it, but there's not a lot of story to it. It's really mostly combat. The environments aren't very huge, but they are detailed. It's a lot of fun to play as Darth Vader and Luke Skywalker, and they're adding more characters. They've added Greedo. They have Han Solo, Princess Leia. You can play as stormtroopers, so it's a lot of fun for, you know, quick pick me up. You can actually take control of a TIE fighter X-wing. You can play large campaign battles, and you can pilot the little walkers. I'm not sure if you can pilot an AT-AT, but they actually have one of the environments coming out slated for this August 2016, is the Death Star. So I'm sure everybody's stoked for that. It's one of the DLCs. I'm not sure how many DLCs there will be, but it needs some improvement. But for what it is, for being able to immerse yourself in the Star Wars universe as one of the characters and just have some fun, you know, with the whole combat aspect and lightsabers and blasters and whatnot, it's fun. Batman, Arkham City, there was also Arkham Asylum, I think. One of the best Batman games I've ever played. A lot of fun. The combat gets repetitive. One of the first games to have this kind of style of combat, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. Along with, like, the God of War, I think, which is here. But yeah, this is a good story, too, in graphics. God of War 3. Played all of them, and I can't remember if I finished this or got real close to it, but this game has epic boss fights in it, great environments, a lot of hacking, slashing, and killing things in just a brutal way, brutal ways, I guess you could say. That's a great game. Mass Effect 2. Great game. Didn't get a chance to finish it. I still need to get back to this. RPG game, sci-fi RPG game. Definitely check that out, though. It's really good. Assassin's Creed Brotherhood. I only bought this for the multiplayer aspect, which is phenomenal. Well, this is old now. I don't know if you can still play this on EA's servers, but this is where they introduced this assassin style multiplayer mode where you would actually have to hide in crowds so as not to be seen by the other multiplayers or the other players who are trying to hunt you down, and everyone's trying to hunt each other down. So it's a very interesting mechanic, and I purchased it just for that. And I think some of the inspiration from my plague doctor subconsciously may have come from this. Here's Batman Arkham Asylum. Again, great game. Great, I get to play as Batman and fight all the different villains. Fantastic. Diablo 3, Reaper of Souls. Not impressed. I don't know what it is about this game, but we got a code with it where you could start with a certain item. But our son and I, we would play on the highest difficulty. There was another difficulty that was that you couldn't get to unless you completed the game first or something. But we played it like expert or something, and it was just, we were so OP. We were getting so many item drops, and it just became like too easy. We were just, nothing challenging about it. The story was interesting, but the gameplay became repetitive. Yes, it's Diablo. That's the point of the game. So I'm not complaining about the purpose of the game, really, and its style so much as it just was like our characters were so OP. There was just to put the, even with the difficulty all the way up. So I don't know if they fixed that recently or what, but we just kind of lost interest in that. Here's that Skylanders game again. Mini ninjas. This is a fun little game where you get to play as little ninja characters. They each have their own little attack style and weapon. So this is a fun little game, nice little story. It gets a little repetitive. Not a lot of story to it, but it's somewhat interesting. It's cool for the kids though. And you can play, I'm not sure if you can play a two player. No, it's one player. But we used to play with our son. I'd sit him on my lap and I would help him play. This is when first getting him into the video games when he was a little bit younger. So here's a Lego, the Lego series of video games, Lord of the Rings, Batman 2, and Marvel Superheroes. These are fun little games. They kind of got old quick and a little repetitive, I think, but you know, they had some story in it, so I think we played those before the Lego movie came out. Just amazing how big the Lego world or universe has become. Alright, Marvel Superhero Squad. I mean, nothing I would recommend, but it's just a fun game to play as all the different little... It was based on a cartoon. So, something fun to own. We were kind of into the cartoons at one point. Rayman Origins. This is a great game, but the problem with this one, it's a platformer. It got so difficult. One of those platform games where there's timing, and you gotta be so precise, and you gotta collect all these different things to unlock these different areas. And we just got stuck and frustrated and kind of lost interest. So, very interesting, unique kind of game, but a little bit repetitive. Not much of a story, but the graphics, different environments were kind of cool. So it was kind of a fun arcade platformer, but just not our style of game, really. Little Big Planet 2, fun for a while, but again, just not our... style of game. So most of the games here I'd highly recommend. A few misses, some games that we probably should revisit, like Little Big Planet 2, but you know, Pokken Tournament, and you know, other games like Uncharted 4 kind of and Battlefront kind of taken us away, but yeah. So that is our collection as of 2016, and so I hope you enjoyed. I hope you got. Hope you found. Hope you play some of these games, or have read some of these books, or watch some of the movies. There's so many more games, movies, and films that I've seen that we don't own. I thought it would just be fun. Have fun with this little series that was supposed to be one video. Hopefully you enjoyed. Hopefully you remember playing some of these things or watching some of the movies. And if anything, you know, at this point you've fallen asleep, or at least enjoyed some ASMR or whatever it is you might be focusing on. Some kind of task, perhaps. Alright, so thanks again for watching. Stay tuned for another special video, pretty sure right after this one. Really excited about it. And hope to see you in another video real soon. Take care of yourself, and until next time.